All right, welcome back. We've just, well, there's been an addition, and I guess it's only fit and proper for me to quickly introduce someone who has joined us. He barely made it, but we'll leave the stories for later on. Onyewuchi Nwachukwu joins us for the show tonight, which is good to have you. There are tales to tell. I'll hear them later, but it's good to have.
The stories of how we made it.
Yeah, you know the dilemma of a pilot. You know, you have to wait till all the passengers listen back. So I brought these guys. I had to wait.
They actually brought us, but they
and I had to go and pack. So that's why they came earlier than.
Okay.
You know, but it's good to be on the show.
All right. Let's move on.
Congo
the
has,
final bit before we leave the AFCON.
Congo has scored.
Okay.
Junior Kabananga with the goal in the 55th minute. So DR Congo are leading Morocco by a goal to nil. Almost 60 minutes of football played now. So there's a goal, first goal of the
and
group.
And by the virtue of that, if it remains like that, DRC will be on top of that group because Togo and the Elephants play a draw. Let me quickly get your impression on that game as we probably saw the game today. Togo and
Cameroon.
Togo and Cote d'Ivoire.
And Cote d'Ivoire, I beg your pardon.
You know, it's not always easy. I mean, the first game, you are just getting into the rhythm of the tournament. You know, so, for me, most times the result of the first game does not really, you know, affect what is going to happen later. The good thing about the result is that the two teams, you know, didn't lose. It was a draw, and let's see how it goes. It's not taking anything away from the Elephants of Cote d'Ivoire. We have seen teams win tournaments after drawing their first two or three games.
Nigeria after the first two.
Yeah.
2013. After the first two.
Yeah.
Okay. Before the tournament started, the talk was about Group D. Those teams, there are teams that are in the same World Cup qualifying group, and they happen to find themselves in the same group for the Nations Cup. So those teams will be playing tomorrow. Black Stars of Ghana and the Cranes of Uganda will be there. And Egypt also will be in action. Talking about Egypt, guys, let's talk about Essam El Hadri. He's going to set a new record. I mean, I don't even expect him to still be in the team of the Pharaohs, but he's going to set the record as the oldest player. He's already 44. If he gets the chance to play, he will be the oldest player to ever have played at the Nations Cup. Rigobert Song holds the record of most appearances at the Nations Cup, but this one, 44. I think it's a remarkable achievement for you.
Yeah, very remarkable. I mean, it's a reward for hard work, persistence, and how you look after yourself. El Hadri, you know, last year when he was recalled to the national team, you know, he was so overwhelmed. I think I still remember that quote where he said that even if they asked him to, you know, pick the balls like a ball boy in the national team,
at some point,
that he was ready to do that. He shows that, you know, the blood of the national team flows in his vein. He wants to continue doing well for the national team as long as he's invited and he's still active. I think it's a lesson for younger players. You know, if you want longevity in the game, you have to be disciplined, work very hard, look after yourself. Then you could go far with some luck. So we want to congratulate El Hadri for what he has achieved for the national team and for himself.
All right, so we'll leave it at that and move on. If there's anything to report, trust us, we'll let you know. All right, guys, let's take a sober reflection and talk about this one. Really, really sad. Crown FC, that's Crown Football Club. Star player, Samson Folorunsho, died. He drowned in an auto crash. It's a really, really an emerging star, you know, passing away like that. And that's how we have to start this segment. Just take a sober reflection and talk about this one, Tony. Not the kind of news you want to hear.
Yeah, we commiserate with the management, the players of Crown FC. We commiserate with the family and the friends of Samson Folorunsho. This incident happened yesterday, somewhere close to Ogbomosho. They had a car crash. The car plunged into water and then it drowned and, of course, passed on that way. Another player was there with him who was able to swim out of the water and is recuperating right now. But it's a very sad one. We pray that God will give his family the opportunity to bear the loss. He's a young player, we're told. Very good player.
Bright future ahead of him.
A lot of future ahead of him. Was looking forward to the start of the new Nigeria National League season when this happened. And we hope that God will, condole his family, comfort them, and his friends and his teammates, so that we don't have things like this to report. I mean, we've had a lot of tragic things to talk about in sports, particularly our league, in the past couple of months. Joseph Izu, and then the Gombe United player, Uzama, that was shot in Benin, and now this one is getting too much. We just hope that God will keep us all safe from all of these kind of tragedies.
Yeah, that's it from this end, and we hope that the family and all the loved ones that will have the fortitude to bear the loss. It's a big one. All right, guys, let's move on and let's talk about the Nigeria Professional Football League. I mean, last week it was trending on Twitter everywhere. The NPFL is back. The NPFL is back, and it lived up to the hype. A lot of skeptics were saying, "Let's see what's going to happen." And what happened in the league proved that is actually what the hype. Well, I guess maybe we should just start with this one and take it out of the way. What you're seeing, what you have on screen, is that controversial game between FC Ifeanyi Oba and Kano Pillars. And this was one of the flash. This was one of the flash points. The free kick that actually went in and has been the subject of interpretation of the rules. The free kick went in; it was scored, but the referee had, whistled, and that it was the end of the half, and a lot of issues started before that. But guys, let me. A lot of arguments.
But Toby was in Kano, so we have eyewitness accounts.
Very true.
But we must commend the guy that got this amateur video for us. I think I have seen this. I've seen it. Toby was at the stadium. Will probably tell us. When I first heard the story, it was Toby that actually put it out on Twitter that the game was being abandoned, and then wanted to find out exactly what happened. So it's just fair for him
to be the one to tell us.
To be the one to start this discussion and
to tell us
exactly what happened. Because there are some people were saying that the referee blew his whistle before the kick was taken. But this video has shown to us that the kick was taken
after the ball went into the net.
The kick was taken before the referee blew his whistle for the end of the half.
That the goal had been scored before. He arranged the wall, he put everything in place.
The kick was taken in, and then he blew. The kick had not, the ball hadn't gotten into the net, but the ball was on his way into the net before the referee blew the whistle. But Toby was there, and that's all the drama.
We have to do this to you. But just tell us what happened. I know that there was also an incident before that goal was scored.
No, not really. I think Kano Pillars scored a legit goal. Imos Gyan was through one-on-one situation with Ezinwa.
Some people said
it wasn't. It wasn't from my view, because Imos Gyan hit the upright, a rebound to Gambo Mohammed, who was very close to go, and he got that one. There was no protest. Everything was peaceful. And then the last 15 minutes, the final was dominating. I mean, you saw that amazing stuff. They dominated, put Pillars into their toes, and they had more possession. I mean, they got about 5 to 6 set pieces. And that was the reason why they got that set pieces that led to controversy. It was late in the game. I think it should be less than 45 seconds in the 2 minutes additional time. And, the center referee awarded that free kick. She put out the wall, and then she stepped back, and Brizagi took the kick. And the ball was in a flight, and we heard the referee sounded for the half to be ended. I mean, it brings a lot of controversy to the game, because everyone thought after you allow the free kick to stay, set the wall, step back.
You should allow
the completion of the free kick.
Yes,
there's a lot of argument about Law 17, how the referee have the power to end the game, but sometimes discretion.
Apart from the penalty,
sometimes you need to use your discretion, you need to use your common sense in this situation, because it was like, from my stopwatch I was using, it was less than 30 seconds after the wall was set up. Then
Was this within the 2 minutes at that time?
It was within the 2 minutes. And she decided to end the game, and it led to the controversy. But funny enough, Ifeanyi Oba
FC Feyenoord had a lot of argument. They went into the tunnel and they came back for the second half. And after they came back, the first 5 minutes, the management, I think the team manager came down to discuss with the players and decided not to play.
Well, let me get on Iwuchi's view. You've seen the video now. You've heard accounts from both sides, and you also hear the law that has been bandied about and several interpretations of that law. So, what's your opinion on all of this?
Well, thank you so much, Yemi. I think first and foremost, we must condemn the abandonment of the game by players and officials.
In whatever circumstances.
In whatever circumstances.
Yeah, I agree.
When you abandon a game that more than 20,000 fans came to watch, what it means is that you have shortchanged them. Then more than 1 million viewers are watching
on TV.
On pay TV. So, you have simply shortchanged them. So, you have to continue the game. And who says you cannot even win in the remaining minutes? Then, when I had, I think it was Toby that tweeted, referee Folisho Ajayi, the first thing that struck me, the final day of last season, the same referee officiated Plateau United and Heartland. We are still
the ripple effect.
The officiating that day still was worse than horrendous.
Yes, and the footages show that the goal that was disallowed, you know, was a legitimate goal. But even the assistant referee was already moving to the center.
Yeah,
it's like
was already moving to the center when she disallowed that goal for reasons best known to her. So for me, if Iban has not done well, do you reward that person with promotion? No. So when I had that, I said, okay, let's give her the benefit of the doubt. But from what we have seen, I mean, his discretion is better part of valor. If all of us are going through the textbooks, perhaps we won't be where we are today.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to go out of the box. Common sense dictates that you have formed, like everybody said, you have formed the war, organized the war, you have,
signal for the direct kick.
You have outlined the line was there, you know, to demarcate
you allowed the kick to be taken off.
I mean, when you stop for a free kick, you can as well look at your wristwatch, take the ball before the kick was taken, and move away. Nobody will argue. But I mean, what she has done is travesty. And you see, for me, before now, we've been trying to absorb the LMC from blame. I think you don't allow somebody to pour sand into your garage. That's what we say, local palace. They are taking the credit for whatever achievement, but now they have to involve the NFF Referees Appointment Committee, whoever the leadership of NRA, in a robust deliberation. You can't spoil the show for us. Get us the best referees to officiate. Every weekend, we see the same faces in the EPL, for goodness sake. You have to do well to get into that clique.
You know, so performance gets you there.
So I think the LMC must stand on their grounds. You have to get the best reference.
I'm interested in asking you because we have to talk about the developments today.
The punishment from the...
Before we even get to the problem, talking about the performance of the referee, the league management company seems to be happy with that performance.
No. The NFF. The NFF have asked that the ref. I mean, I think the ref is... is to be withdrawn from...
No, you mean talking about the LMC being happy with the referee decision?
No.
I was there.
Yeah.
I mean,
that is out of the question.
You know, the truth of the matter is, you know, after the issue happened, the league management chairman, the league management company chairman, Chiwudiko, was there. And luckily for us, all the referee hierarchy was also there. I mean, from the NFF referee committee chairman and the NRA chairman was also present. Fresh and Tadi Aziz, and immediately the LMC chairman expressed, you know, bitterness and, you know, disappointment about how Folisho handled the game. Because, I mean, in such a big game, like Onye said, a lady or a woman, so to speak, who had big such controversy with the last game of the season, then we rewarded her one of the biggest game of the new season. I mean, it's not really fair on the league development.
We have to go on a break, but there's a lot to talk about. The angle of a lot of issues into this: the LMC, the NFF, the referees committee, the both clubs. We also hear that the principal actor in that drama, from the side of the FC Ifeanyi Oba, that the club has taken a decision. We'll talk about all of that and more when we return from this break. Join us again.